I think there was a lot of like kind of key words that came into my mind when I was listening to both of those great presentations. Biggest thing for me is we don't engage with our public enough in terms of what we should be delivering in local communities. And the second thing is we don't collaborate enough. We're not an open and transparent industry. And I think a huge part of actually improving and being able to accelerate what we do and do it better is about collaborating together. There's quite a lot, and we saw from those slides there, of different stakeholders and players in the whole process of planning and construction. And that is too many opinions that most often conflict each other. Therefore, we actually end up spending a lot longer in doing things. And as what Ewan's slide showed is that we're quite inefficient in terms of how we deliver stuff. So the introduction of technology that can kind of cut out some of the process to give people better access to data, I think is very much needed.
Following on from Michelle and the two presentations, I agree in all respects. In architecture, we've seen a massive change, a progressive change in technology in the introduction of BIM, which is going to completely revolutionise the whole process of the building industry. And BIM isn't a program as such, it's a process. And so I see that actually what we're going to start seeing in the planning process is decisions trying to be made earlier, because that essentially is the process, so that later on down the line, when it costs more to make the changes and there's less and there's more time constraints, that you will be able to cut out any unforeseen sort of issues which might arise. So in my mind, I think that also relates itself to how we collaborate and how we consult with the public, how we engage with the public, how we engage with decision makers and stakeholders. So if it's an early process using digital technologies, I think that we can begin the journey together.
This question is more for, I think, Ewan. So it sounds really great what you're trying to do to digitize and open up the planning process for the public, but how much positive feedback and participation are you getting from councils who sometimes benefit from it being very opaque and their ability to negotiate in secrecy, I guess, not secrecy, but without the transparency?
I spent 6 years working for one of these councils that negotiate in a lot of opaqueness and maybe not transparency. In actual fact, lack of transparency is a problem for local authorities, because it increases uncertainty, and no one wants uncertainty. Local communities don't want uncertainty, politicians don't want uncertainty, developers don't want uncertainty. So transparency and kind of good data can overcome that. It can actually create a level playing field where all these negotiations can actually kind of be opened up, and actually you can have a proper a reasonable negotiation with all the different parties involved in development. Does that answer your question a little bit?
And Michelle, from you'll see opaqueness on the developer side sometime. What's your view on that?
So, I never normally think of planning officers or local councils as actually wanting to have the secretiveness. So I am a viability consultant, so I work with mostly developers in putting in planning applications and assessing the level of affordable housing. And there is a perception that developers want the secrecy. Now, that's not always the case, and there's some elements of a viability appraisal that a developer will have to keep secret because it's commercially sensitive. But they're quite open with a lot of information they share with the local councils. I think there's just a want of keeping it secret, just a lack of trying to be open. And I think there is the introduction of a lot of things that are happening, particularly in London, where local councils are looking to lay down the law with a lot of developers and saying, be transparent. Now, the challenge with transparency is we can tell the public everything as part of what goes on as part of a planning application process and the negotiation. But what you need is for the general public to understand what that means. And that's the challenge where someone sees a number or an appraisal and thinks, I know that you can get more somewhere down the road from me, but there are other things that are affecting that number. And so there's a little bit of an education we have to do for everybody in trying to kind of be more open and transparent.
George?
Yeah, so I've, again, following on from Michelle, I've actually had to think about how this could work a little bit better in terms of digitalization of the planning process. One idea could be that if the planning process right now is very much tail-ended, sort of following on from what I said before about trying to make decisions early. And actually, there are decisions which are reasonably fixed during the planning process. And that could be put into key stages along those lines, which, so to improve transparency, I think we should have an online hub, something which is a planning hub, which so once a development site is ready to sort of begin the planning process, there should be key stages set out for everyone to see, including residents and planners, and the developer be held responsible to meet each of those key stages. So for example, the first one could be we need a massing and bulk of form to be agreed at a certain point. At that point, it comes up onto the online portal. With all these things, to make people understand, to come on the journey, you can't just sort of put a big mass on there and expect people to say yes or no or like or whatever. So I think you need to also have a part of the story. So I think there needs to be, you know, design workshops, collaborations between the planners and the architects and developers. Once there's an agreed mass, that should then hit a key stage for mass. And then moving on to the next stages, which could be parking and servicing, could be affordable housing, etc. And so then the residents know exactly what's happening at each key stage. They know that they're involved with each of those key stages, and they can make an opinion. So that by the time it comes to the end, you don't have public consultations which aren't engaged and actually become more constructive.
In your project, Fran, what have you seen as the importance of, in particular, data visualization?
Oh, well, yes. Yeah, so the visualization can be really important because realistically, you can share all the data and all the calculations, but you can't expect most people to read or understand those. Not because they can't, but just they're not that interested. Even policymakers within government are often don't have the time or inclination to really understand all the sums. So it's important to present the information in a visual way. I just wanted to come back to what you were saying about opacity. So actually our experience with planning departments, for example, is not that they're particularly trying to be opaque, but actually they're opaque to themselves sometimes. So different people or different teams just can't even see the reasoning behind each other's decisions. And regardless of transparency to the outside world, I think you get quite a lot from just being transparent to themselves. And that in itself would be quite a big benefit and would probably improve some decisions.
Yep. Paul Whittlesey from DCLG. There's a couple of points I picked up. I think you hinted at about skills, and obviously planning departments have taken a big hit in part of the cuts. And I was wondering about how skilled up local authority planning departments are in terms of interpreting the data, understanding it, how to present it, how to use it. So there's that point. And then there's a danger of more opaqueness, if there's such a word as opaqueness, around selective use of data. So you could use data to justify a decision that actually, you know, if people don't understand what that data is really saying and how it's being used, you know, just manipulates things towards a particular decision in terms of a planning application or one way or another.
Yep. Start with Fran, yep, that seems ideal.
Yeah, those are really good questions. So in planning, as in most other areas of local government, we're seeing a real loss of staff, and that means that those staff are under an awful lot of pressure. The way I see the job of people like us or of other technical people is to automate out the bits of their job that are essentially the grunt work, which they might have historically just spent time doing on paper. Automate that away so that they can focus their time on doing the actual skills of planning that have to be done by a human who really, really understands planning. So really just trying to get their time to be the most useful possible. And I think that's the most constructive thing we can really do.
Just to reiterate that point, one of the things that we often talk about is what we're trying to do is freeing planners to plan. So kind of, as Fran just kind of succinctly put it, automate these aspects. But with regards to kind of twisting data and interpreting data, that happens already. I don't think us having more data is going to make us interpret data in a different way. To mean the negotiations that are happening over the pre-application meetings on a day-to-day basis are based on data. But at the minute, because the sources of these data are so obscure and the workings out are so obscure and very hard to understand, I think that's where the problem is. I think we will always kind of be trying to make our point and argue a point. Developers will try and reduce affordable housing. Local planners will try and increase affordable housing. That will happen. And I think that's fine. What we need to do is, how far can we standardize on benchmark the data sets that we're actually using. And I think transparency and digitization will go one step towards that.
Michelle?
I just want to add to that point, because that's actually one of my biggest concerns in terms of giving access to data where data is not actually understood. And we don't have the right skills at the moment within a lot of our planning authorities and to be able to interpret data. Which is not to say that we couldn't have that, but if we're cutting budgets, we're not going to get there. And I've seen, as a viability consultant, instances where negotiations take a lot longer than what they should with the planning authority, because an independent consultant who sits alongside the planning authority is there to demonstrate why they're being paid a fee. So there will be discussions that go on for a very long time. If we can cut out that process or reduce that process through having access to data that everybody shares, that could help. And what I've seen, or what we're seeing at the moment, is the Greater London Authority and our mayor is trying to help that process through the introduction of a viability team within the GLA. So it's saying that actually planning officers themselves may not have the skills that are needed, but actually what we'll do is we'll have a team that actually does understand what viability means, and they will be able to interpret the data, which should help reduce the process.
George, can you comment? You mentioned BIM earlier. Now, I think there's a skills issue around actually these new technologies. So I, not too long ago, presented to a planning school and their master's unit, and none of them had heard of BIM. How do you see, from an architectural perspective, that skills challenge of actually having the ability to understand and manage data modeling, digital frameworks?
Yeah, I mean, with old technologies and high sort of big data technologies, you can get overwhelmed by it. So it's about understanding what you want from that technology and what you want to extract from that technology. So what we're seeing in architecture is more and more, you know, it's growing. The tide is shifting, you know, from 2D drawings to 3D now. So everything's 3D, and not just 3D in the sense of what you can see about what it can produce, what the numbers are behind there, what the information behind each of that, what's sitting there as a virtual building. So what I'd say is that, you know, if we're going to use these more, then we need to know what we want to get out of it. So I think we don't necessarily need a model maker in the planning department, for example. We don't necessarily need someone to build all these models. We need someone to be able to understand how to extract what they need from that model, and to have that model with the information within it for them to extract it. What I think is quite an important part of it is that it is all built in 3D. You don't have to, you know, use your imagination on a plan or on an elevation or a section. It's actually there for you to see. And what is happening now more and more is the introduction of virtual reality. Virtual reality is still sort of kind of futuristic. It's, you know, you've got your goggles where you look around like you're in some sort of sci-fi film. But more and more, we're going to start seeing just on your phones. You know, you click on the camera setting, you've got the app, or you click and it uploads. So maybe you're in a development area, a key sensitive view, or a particular viewpoint, and you can just get your phone. A bit like maybe on your Facebook pages, you're getting overloaded with people with funny things on their face and things on, like, you know, the different settings you can put on your phone when it comes up. That could be a building, that could be a proposal sitting in front of you in your street scene. It could be just a shop front which is changing its design. So I think it's there, it's ready, and I think that's the next stages, is that's where we'll start to see things become much more interactive with people.
We've been doing a green infrastructure audit in our local borough, work for the council, and we've been trying to use a lot of data sources and pulling them together. Green infrastructure is multifunctional, so a lot of wide-ranging data. And what I've found is there's been quite a lot of mistrust, in a way, from the various specialists who we've tried to bring on board with this. Possibly with the results of the data sort of indicating a direction that we should be going. But because of the mistrust of not understanding and mistrusting the data, the concern they're being replaced, their professional expertise is being replaced by sort of technology. And so it's been actually the big challenge has been to overcome the other professionals thinking, what are you, a lot of nervousness around it. And I, it's an understanding of the data and how to interpret it, but also, so what? How important is ground truthing or ground proving the data so that they have more confidence in the use of it?
Really, a conflict across a lot of different industries. On the one hand, data analysis are going to encroach more and more into those kind of professions. So to some extent, they're going to have to deal with it. And to some extent, no ground truthing you can do will ever be good enough if they've decided it's no good. So there's one side of it that's just, yeah, this is happening, you can ignore it or you can work out how to deal with it. Of course, it is important to have the data correct and correctly checked, but that's always relevant to the context that you're in. So you're asking the question, is this better than the alternative which we could have? How do we know that it's better? How can we test that it's better? And I think as long as we ask ourselves those questions appropriately, then that's where we have to go. But yeah, it's a really familiar challenge. When data first enters into any profession, there are a group of experts who just are very unhappy about it because they can see that it's going to change their roles.
Maybe not so much for you, but I think it's great that your data is being challenged. I think that's a good thing in principle, and we should always be challenging where does that data come from. But the way I see it is that through kind of transparency of where your data is coming from and how you're collecting it, etc., I think that's how you can overcome some of that. You talk about infrastructure and green infrastructure. We're working with some people who are actually using satellite imagery recognition to identify green infrastructure. So of course you can challenge that and you can say, well, but it starts becoming relatively objective if we show the workings out of where that data is coming from. And in exactly the same way, you can challenge the data of the professionals and how have they collected their data, because the likelihood is it's not going to be any better or any more robust than yours.
Just want to add from that, from the point of view is I am a consultant, so I'm a professional consultant, so technically it should be in my interest to prolong the process of me being appointed by a developer to negotiate a planning application, but it's not. It really is not in my interest to do that. I work for a consultancy that is very much pro change and modernization and growth. And for us, what we don't want to do is be stuck in an industry that's stuck in the past. I don't want to be known as a consultant that what makes me good at what I do is that I have access to data. That to me doesn't make you good at what you do. I want to be good at what I do because I have insight, I have knowledge, I have ideas. And I think more professional consultants are moving towards that way. But I do agree at the point that some will inevitably fall behind in thinking that change means I lose my clients. But that shouldn't be the case.
With the idea of BIM, you sort of speed things up, but it doesn't necessarily mean you just make decisions earlier and you have to analyze what you're doing much at an earlier stage, which effectively means that you're front-loading the workload. So the workload essentially is the same amount, but you're just doing a lot more much sooner and hopefully having a better outcome at the end of it.
Sean Curtin, I'm a surveyor, so not a planner. I really enjoyed you and Anne Fran's presentations, very dynamic. And my question is really your sort of philosophical feeling on the data. Do you feel the ultimate goal of all of the things that you said, which will benefit having more sort of information tying up? Is this for the public? Is this for true transparency? Or will this data just be held by the industry? And the reason I ask is that obviously the changes that some of us want to make, if the data is more available, then it will work its way into the media or activist groups, and then they'll put pressure on it. And if we take an example which was mentioned, the 35% affordable housing, which is the mayor's target going up to 50%, at the moment, we don't really know who's achieving it because it's all very opaque. I did actually ask two building companies on Tuesday about that, and they didn't respond. But if you do have this data, then obviously the developers will be put more under the microscope. So what is your ultimate goal, or what would you like to see, and do you think there's a balance? Thanks.
Developers will be put under the microscope more. We'll then be able to question if their 20% profit margin is realistic, if their construction costs are being realistic, if their land remediation costs are realistic. But also, the politicians will be put under the microscope, because how are they then making a balanced decision? And the planners will be put under the microscope, and the architects. And we will just, I think everyone is going to be scrutinized a lot better. Transparency means more scrutiny. But I kind of see that as a good thing. And I think in the end of the day, it might actually be better for everyone. Because over time, this issue of certainty, I think when there's more scrutiny, when we know we're going to be scrutinized, we'll make sure that we'll just be as transparent and upfront and use whatever construction cost benchmarks we might have, because that just speeds up the process.
Yeah, it's a really interesting question about transparency and where the benefits go. So I think it would be great to have more public data and transparent data for the public. Actually, I think the public maybe even gets more benefit from not necessarily the data being transparent, but within the professional parties involved, just them using data well and making better decisions as a result. I think that in itself would have huge positive side effects for the public, even if the public never ever looked at the data. That would still be a massive first step. I think transparency also would be very positive because it creates external pressures, but that's a much more political issue and harder to handle. I think just getting the functioning of the machine right, as well as exposing the workings, are two very important public benefits.
Just to add to that point around transparency, so one of the key things that I would love to see happen is planning officers in different parts of the country actually seeing precedents happening in similar towns or cities outside of their own area. I think for me, a lot of expertise from planning officers is actually informed by what they've been through themselves rather than from learning what others are doing. So I'm hoping transparency in terms of being open within industry helps move that along. How transparent we are with the general public, I still struggle with, because to me it comes all back down to your interpretation of data. And if you get that wrong, we can end up with people lobbying for things that shouldn't be lobbied for, or people, activists, saying that you got 35% affordable housing on that site, why can't you get it on that site, but not understanding the uniqueness of the situation. So I will always kind of slightly worry about that, but actually giving more access than what we currently do is probably for the best.
Is this an opportunity at the moment, with all this data coming in, to actually monitor the planning process retrospectively? Because the planning process doesn't have a good opinion by the public, and there's no real feedback of whether the plan has been successful, whether the quality of life for the people who are going to use that place or whatever it is, it may not be a building. Is there an opportunity here with the collection of all this data to use that to inform future five-year plans?
I think absolutely. So one of the first slides of my presentation was about all the different sources of data. And one of them is monitoring. We have to monitor plans. We currently, every local plan is monitored. It's monitored on a number of KPIs. London's strategic plan is monitored. I think there's 13 KPIs. I don't think that's good enough. We can't really monitor the success of a plan for 9 million people on 13 KPIs. We can actually, but what we can do with availability of basically both sensors and social media and all these new technologies is actually do exactly that. Start monitoring things a lot better. We have lots of debates about the number of vacant properties in London. And the reality is we don't actually know how many vacant properties there are in London. We can estimate it. Some areas have more than others. But a lot of the figures that you see banded around the media are actually based on kind of very tenuous assumptions and surveys, because we don't actually have enough data about how the city is working today. So I think absolutely, I think there's a huge opportunity to just understand how cities work a little bit better now.
So just to add to that, so in terms of monitoring, I think one of the biggest challenges is to make sure it actually happens. So we set Section 106 agreements in place, and there's always parts of those agreements that say you've got to monitor this when the scheme completes. It's the questions around how long can you actually monitor for? Do you do 12 months after? Do you do 24 months after? Do you do 36 months after? And then do we have the resource within our teams, within our planning authorities, to be able to do that? Or should there be another team that should be set up to do that? Now, a part of my role at my organization is I'm quite promoting the agenda for pre-manufacturing solutions in housing delivery. And the biggest challenge we have with that is demonstrating the quality of the product once it's built is actually the quality that somebody wants to live in. So we're looking at a lot of ways in which we can do monitoring there. But saying that we're going to do it now and actually doing it are two very different things, so we have to make sure it happens.
George?
Yeah, we try to, well, I mean, we're a big housing architect, so we've done a lot of properties down the years, really, down in the decades. And we always think that actually the most important thing would be to have post-occupancy results to understand, you know, what we think are good places and good homes. Are they actually lived in as we thought they'd be? You know, are the energy ratings what we think they're going to be? And actually, these are difficult. It's difficult to get into the properties, get people to engage with you. It's also difficult just to sort of, you know, go back once a property's been sold on by a developer and all that sort of thing. So actually, properties now, particularly new builds, do have their own intranet service within, so residents forums online. And actually, we think there could be a great opportunity here to let people on their own accord, I suppose, fill in what they think about how to, and there might be a set of particular criteria set by local authorities to these different developments, which can then feed back and then can be tapped into a later date, which can then help make them decisions on what new build proposals have worked and what haven't.
I'm just wondering what the panel think about developers using local authorities to serve CPOs for development. This has been exercised in London, for instance, to the detriment of local communities' amenities. It's a very controversial sort of power to use, and I wonder with some of your exercises if you're able to draw in community representation in all this, because I think this is critical. I think the community feel they're being disenfranchised, and I think it does need to be addressed.
Michelle, start on that.
So for me, the biggest thing is engagement with the public as part of preparing a local plan. So all too often we have local plans prepared, which, as Ewan pointed out early, take like 5 years to prepare and then become irrelevant when they are in place. So they're out of date. So there needs to be a lot more engagement and a quicker process of getting those plans in place, including the community within actually the preparation, so that when we come on to the next stage of actually delivering against those local plans, we've already engaged, we've already got the community actually seeing what is going to take place and had their involvement and what works best for them. The points around developers using the local authorities to actually CPO land. So as a viability consultant, I am involved in a lot of projects where there's CPO processes put in place, sometimes used positively, sometimes negatively. And when I say positively, I mean the people that are actually CPO are rewarded for actually moving into a new home. But one thing that has to happen is actually making sure that CPOing of land where there is a community engagement, that's actually replaced and put back there. So an onus has to be put back onto both the developer and the local authority and planning authority to make sure that actually happens.
I mean, I think the use of CPO in the UK is very rare compared to other countries. If we think it's used in a bad way around here, you should have a look at other countries. And the idea that developers can force the local authority to CPO anything as well, I don't think that actually happens. I think CPO is something which is very rarely used. It's quite a big deal for any local authority to actually use their CPO powers. And it's usually done to facilitate the quality of a development, which, in my view, quite often might be good. With regards to the use of digital tools to get local communities involved, I think there's a huge opportunity there. But the first thing that yesterday I was speaking at a neighborhood planning event where lots of citizen activists were talking about the potential for digital tools. And then someone said, oh yeah, but lots of people aren't online. Lots of people don't have access to these digital tools. And I think, well, that's an absolutely reasonable point. We need to get people to use these digital tools. If they don't today, I think they're missing out on opportunities. And I think all of us have a kind of near responsibility to kind of show people the opportunities and the added value that these new tools have available to us and can help the way that they can help influence developments. And if you look at the way that kind of local campaigning has happened in the last few years, you can see the benefits of digitization. Whether it's people like More Light, More Power in the Bishopsgate Goods Yard, whether it's people like Save the South Bank. These are two incredibly powerful and effective campaigns, and both of them stop development. So the digital tools are available and they do happen if people use them properly.
I'm Howard Albertini, I'm town planner at Slough Borough Council. I have to admit, I'm not probably the best person to take on board new technology, but I agree with the approach put forward. It's really good, and I'm very aware of things that I write. I know other people have written across the country as well, so why repeat it? So it's a good idea. But just bear in mind some of the sort of issues that might come up. Councils have no time to help with reorganising themselves. They're dealing with planning applications, policies, putting resources into reorganising isn't easy. If you put it out to someone else, there's the issue of loss of control. Consultants do things which you feel you aren't a benefit to us. So it's getting that message across. Sorry, it's how to deal with that issue of getting everyone on board when it's a national system.
I think that's a really good point. And I think in a way, the responsibility is in people like Steph and I, who work for this government agency called the Catapult, to actually link these technologies and to make sure to implement them. There's no point in creating all these amazing tools if no one's going to use them. And which is why kind of a lot of the work that we're doing is, as I said, is bridging that gap between the practitioners, one who don't even have time to consider anything different than the way you're doing things because you've got a massive list of things to do, and to work out how we can actually save you time, how we can actually make you make better decisions and do more of the stuff you like doing, the stuff that you're good at. So, for example, I find it amazing that we still have people, planners, qualified planners in local authorities whose job is to validate planning applications. That's not what these guys want to be doing. They want to be making complex decisions and complex balances between negotiating affordable housing and green space and whatever. But I think absolutely, I think it's incredibly challenging, and it will be challenging over the next few years in our future planning program to actually start implementing some of these tools. And we are already working with some local authorities, and some kind of have a bit more leeway. For example, Plymouth Local Planning Authority have been doing some really interesting innovations. We're now working with Southwark in London and Hackney in London. Manchester have done some really interesting innovations. So I think the challenge is, what can we learn, both us from our side, from how we've implemented these tools in some local authorities, and how can we convince you guys at Slough that these tools will actually help you and make sure that in 2 years' time you're actually using them and it will make your life better?
I'm quite convinced we need better technology. We absolutely have a lot of problems as strategic planners bringing in the infrastructure actors like the National Health Service and, I don't know, even community facility operators, that we need this information in order to plan. It's very difficult. But the reality is, of course, that we are scrabbling around for pennies. So in your experience so far, maybe with your conversations with the GLA or anybody higher, how is it seen that this kind of expensive, most likely, technology would be financed? I know we've had the white paper that's telling us, all right, perhaps you can increase fees, but you know, what is this actually going to look like for us in 5 years? Where are we going to get this money from?
One, it's not going to be expensive. I think it's important. And I think in the next few years, you're going to start seeing people like Google and IBM knocking on your guys' door and saying, here's a service that we can provide you. And it's kind of cheap, but I'd say be suspicious of them. I'll give you an example. There's a local authority in London which currently looks at around 800 household planning applications per year. 400 of them are refused. It takes about 4 hours per applicant to process each application. I'm not very good at arithmetic, but if you work out the amount of time that is spent on applications which are actually refused is huge. They're actually now experimenting with, to what extent can they do some automated screening of these applications so they reduce the number of applications which are refused and they have to spend 4 hours processing. And if they do just that just by half, that will more than pay for any new technology and any new innovation. And I think one of the challenges that we have at the Catapult is how can we make sure that one, that message gets through, and two, that these tools are kind of are given to you in a way which you don't get trapped in some complex licensing agreement. I imagine Fran will have some views on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really fair question. Local government just doesn't have spare money, so any solutions have to be very aware of that. I think the way that we've been looking at it is looking at places where, as you say, there's there's time spent which maybe doesn't need to be spent, or there is money spent which doesn't need to be spent, and saying how do we produce a solution which costs less than what it saves? And that's got to be the bottom line. So we can only introduce things that make the situation better rather than worse with respect to money. And as you also say, computers, once you've done the initial learning on it with a computer, it can cover huge volumes of things very cheaply. That's the great benefit of them. So the expensive part is the training process, which things like Innovate UK and the Catapult fund the work for, so that then there's just a system which is there for all authorities, is the idea.